Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Though I suppose in this session, this is the last presentation, I hope to make it a little more interesting because I am taking you to one of the northeast corners of India, Nagaland, and try to expose you their cultural activities and also what the scenario is at present in a very rich forest resource state, if not properly managed, how it can come down. Though it is not a case study, we try to see how things are going on in the last 25, 30 years. One of the main problems we had was the lack of data or reliable data to come to any conclusion. So whatever I am presenting here is an indicative in nature, but nevertheless, it also represents the present scenario. Well, needless to say, the entire Northeast and the Western Ghats and to some extent Andaman Nicobar Islands all form a biodiversity rich regions, and Northeast especially because the confluence of the Eastern Himalayas and the Myanmar area is very rich in biodiversity. Just to cite an example, even in 2 years ago, they have discovered one of the orchids there, Cura stylis Mohanramai. So despite the amount of anthropogenic pressures in those areas, still we find newer and newer species. So also many universities and educational institutions send the students for various research projects pertaining to amphibians, which is also supposed to be one of the quite rich in Nagaland especially. So it forms the Indo-Burma, Eastern Himalayas, and having a very high level of endemism. And the state is basically a rural in nature, with 80% of the population living in villages, and 70%, of course, depending on agriculture, animal husbandry, and forestry for their livelihood. So you can imagine the whole activities pertaining to the land-based scenario, and there'll be tremendous pressure. Maybe initially when they began in 60s, 64 was the formation of the statehood, and those days, of course, because the population being much less, the pressure was not much. But with the passage of time, there has been tremendous pressure on various resources. And another interesting part is, of course, many of you have already been aware of the slash and burn cultivation or the shifting cultivation. In Northeast, many of the states, there are 7 states in Northeast, and many of the states do have this slash and burn cultivation in various forms. And Nagaland, in fact, almost the entire districts, entire state, almost all the districts follow this. This has almost been their socio-cultural activity, where I think many of their festivals, many of their annual ceremonies is coinciding with this shifting cultivation. Various processes or various steps in shifting cultivation. So I'll briefly explain about the shifting cultivation, what is being practiced in Nagaland also. When coming to the forest, we have about 52.04% of the geographical area is under forest still. And as per the National Forest Policy, about 66% of the areas under the hills should be under forest. But though it might have been more earlier, presently the it's about 52%. And what is most important is the ownership pattern. As you have been listening to our earlier speakers from India, rest part of the country have forests which are controlled by the government or under the ownership of the government. So most of the policies and programs and the action plans which have been envisaged by the government can be effectively implemented in those areas because you have the whole thing under your control. But here, we have 88% of the forest under community are private. Why I say community or private is, again, we have about 16 different tribes. So not all the tribes follow the community forests, and not all the tribes follow the individuals. There are community forests which are owned by the entire village community, and there are forests which are owned by the private individuals, which goes on from generation to generation in the clan form. So we have both the types in the entire state. And only 11.7% is with the government, and this is also bulk of it during the British period. They have declared, this was erstwhile a part of the Assam state, and during those times they have declared several areas as reserve forest, and the national, subsequently it has been declared as wildlife areas. And apart from that, very few areas which have very good potential for conservation of some of the unique species, the government had purchased those areas and have declared. That's a very less in number and also in extent. So only 11.7% of the government, because this statement basically forms the entire discussion what we are going to have. Coming to the forest per se, the forest types are very wide ranging, and probably so because of the biodiversity also. We have the tropical wet evergreen forests, and also we have the pine forests. Some of the economically important species we have here, and most of it are hardwoods. And some of them, like Diptrocarpus macrocarpus and Shorea assamica, are basically used for peeling veneers. And we have the pine and Pinus casea and Quercus in combination or association. And there are a host of non-timber, aromatic, and medicinal plants, including Panax ginseng, pseudo ginseng, available there. And Taxus bucata is another important medicinal plant. Now, this is the pie chart depicting the ownership status. in fact, the Article 371 of the Indian Constitution specifies that the land and its resources belongs to the people of Nagaland. There is no Naga without a piece of land. So every Naga who is staying there in Nagaland, resident of Nagaland, or say indigenously Naga, owns a piece of land. So by that constitution and with the ownership pattern, you can imagine the entire ownership and the decisions taken by the communities or the village communities, how it will affect or impact on the forest resources. Now, as we see in almost all the places, the forests are supposed to have a multidimensional role and supposed to cater to the needs of environmental, economical, social, and cultural, and there is no exception in the state. But again, the emphasis would be more here towards the social, cultural, and economical because of the land ownership pattern. Well, when we go through the economic aspect of it, probably you'll be able to appreciate this. Now, when we looked into the forest aspects, we saw that the various several factors influenced the pricing, availability of timber, and the demand and supply position. And one of these is availability of the timber and the demand for the preferred species for a particular purpose, and these resulted in the price variations also. We'll go into the detail a little bit later. Now, this is what it is. What we found out was timber availability and the price fluctuation or variation is mainly due to the timber-dependent economy, in the sense the people, since it is their own land and their own forests. Earlier to that, in the earlier period, they were using it mainly for their bona fide uses, like if they wanted to build a house or if they wanted to have some kind of a for preparation of rice and other things, any equipment they wanted to make, it's all wooden, and whatever they want to make, they just used to cut it from the forest and make use of it. Especially firewood usage is very high, so all these basic needs were catered by the forest. But with the passage of time, what happened was there was a floodgate opening of the demand from outside the state, and that resulted in kind of economic dimension to the whole scenario. And forest as an entity was seen as some kind of economic resource, economic base. And unfortunately, what happened was there was no proper planning as such. So how much is going out and what is the supplementing thing? So as a result, we see some of the changes. So one is the timber dependent economy, and so also the ownership pattern, as I was explaining. And the third is the zooming or the slash and burn cultivation, which has been extensively going on even today. In fact, many there have been various programs to say mitigate these ill effects and try to incorporate the action, the activity of zooming with the tree growing in various phases, but still it is to give tangible results. But as of now, zooming is still a practice going on, and in fact many of the district administrators have come out and categorically said they should not be doing this burning, because burning not only has caused a lot of damage to the biodiversity and other aspects of the forestry, but it is also causing a lot of damage to life and other property also. And one other aspect is the industries and other sectors which came at a later stage, not in the initial stage, when it came at a later stage, you can see what damage it has done, in the sense without the sustainability of this sustainable dimension of this, what will happen if timber keeps on going out? Now, coming to the timber dependent economy, earlier during the 50s and 70s, as I said, it's mainly used for the construction purpose and for carving and handicrafts, and mainly for the for their own bona fide use. There was plenty of timber available and the demand was much less, and unlike in other places, they have a very strict ownership pattern. In fact, if it belongs to X, X cannot go and cut in a Y forest. So the village will decide where it is to be taken out, or village community will decide where that resources are to be taken out. Even for building a community hall or even for somebody's house also, they will decide it has to be taken from one particular area. So that they will abide by that, because village is the most powerful institution in the entire state. So earlier, the species such as Terminalias and Phoebe golparensis is an important species. Earlier also is a hardwood species even now. And then we had Melaina arborea, and we had Mesua feria, and Morus levigata, and Mansonia dpk. These are all very durable hardwood species which were available in plenty during those days. And going back to 88-89, when I was one of the territorial DFOs, in fact the prices were so low that in a standing tree the owner was only offered about 5 rupees 75 paise per CFT. So you can imagine the entire tree will be around, if it is a 50 CFT tree, hardly it's about 250 rupees for a standing tree. So that was a kind of economy earlier, and people didn't bother about it. The owners did not bother about it initially, and later on when they started seeing the demand outside, then everything, the floodgates really opened. So there was little commercial dimension in the earlier period, and later on 70s and onwards, even now continuing, there was total commercial outlook. And the demand for the hardwood increased by leaps and bounds. In fact, just to say, today also, as of now, there have been a lot of restrictions by the Apex Court, Supreme Court, on removal of timber from Northeast and especially Nagaland. And even today, about 25,000 cubic meter of sawnwood is removed annually. 25,000 meter cubic meters of sawnwood almost add another 25-30%. So that's the quantum of removal annually even today. Then what eventually resulted was those species which are durable and hardwood and plenty available, like mentioned above, started fading away. And the result was availability of lesser known species only in the, these are all again, I should have mentioned it right in the beginning. What I'm talking is all from the natural forests. We are not talking about any plantations. We are not talking about anything else. These are all natural forests. The removal is from the natural forests. So eventually the emphasis or the preference shifted over to lesser known species such as Amura valichai, Chucrasia tabularis, Albizia, Cinnamomum and Adena. These are also quality hardwood, but when kept apart, when kept at par with the other terminalias, these were quite inferior. So, but now what is the scenario is more and more of these species are available in the market. Now just there was a study by Forest Survey of India, and this is the species composition in 85 with Shima valichai as the main, and these are the top five species. You can see here Quercus was there earlier. Quercus has been eventually removed, and Calicarpa and Castanopsis also, which was there earlier, is totally missing in 2010. Though Shima valichai remained. Now, the other species like Melaina arborea and Tectona grandis crept in basically because of the plantation activities. So things have been, say, dynamic, and things have been changing even in the species composition. The reasons for this also is some of the preferred species like Terminalias and Phoebe, there have been excess removal. Because automatically when there is a good demand for those timber in the market, people have been removing. In fact, if you, if I just explain you the way they were selling also, it perturbs everybody. When a contractor goes, he will not say that this is the number of trees. From this end to that end, whatever forests are there, they just give some money to the village, the forest owner. And starting from October, which is the beginning of the season, and March is the ending of the season, March, April. So after the rains and before the next onset of monsoon, whatever he can remove from those forests, he can remove. So what they normally, greedy people do is, they cut more than what they can remove. So whatever they can remove, they'll remove it, and remaining will be rotting in the forest with one season of rains, which is very heavy from starting from April, May, right up to October, the most of the material will go as a waste. So all these reasons also resulted in loss of those preferred species, which probably they were cutting and removing. And then subsequently, the plantations of teak, Melaina, Terminalia, Pinus, and Dobanga also came into picture. But teak and Melaina were more systematically done, whereas Pinus, Dobanga, and to some extent, Terminal plantations were done here and there, but not systematically. But still, demand for commercially important species was very high, and with the less availability of these species, the prices really soared up. Now, this is the standing volume between 85 and 2010. Again, if you see, Shima valichai remained, whereas the other species like Quercus and Dobanga were missing, and newer species came into existence in 2010. This also shows that probably the unsustained removal of the preferred species without practicing any scientific management has really resulted in lesser availability of these very important species, and putting it outside, and as the demand for these species increased, their prices also went very high. And traditional species, as I mentioned about Dobanga and Terminalia, have been slowly replaced by the other alternate species. Though they are hardwood, but they are of lesser or inferior quality. And the viewing forests or timber resources as totally as an economic entity went on increasing from that time onwards. Now this is a graph representing the price of timber. So you can imagine that up to about 85-90, the prices were almost flat. From 85-90 onwards, there was a sudden splurt, basically because there is a mushroom of sawmills started coming up in the border areas of Nagaland. So all the sawmills and plywood factories were completely fed by the timber from Nagaland and Arunachal to a very great extent. So as a result, when timber started going out, so as I said, that the standing tree, which was costing 50 rupees, 250 rupees, started. Even I have purchased timber in my own division at 19 rupees per CFT. So it is unimaginable prices. So even though there is a gap of 20 and odd years still, but it went on, and now today even an ordinary timber fetches as much as 350 to 400 rupees. And the timber which I was telling, even today the 25,000 cubic meters is going, an ordinary hardwood will be fetching around 750 rupees per CFT. And teak, of course, the plantation teak, which is now coming in the market, fetches as much as 1,200 rupees per CFT.
Dr. Fisher, yeah. 3 minutes.
Oh, okay. Now, the zooming practice which I have been telling, an estimated area is about 900,000 hectares is subjected to zooming, and annually about 131,000 hectares. Though the intensity of zooming and the extent of zooming has really affected the quality of the forest as well as the extent of the forest. And the zooming cycle, which was earlier 4 to 5 years, has now, which was earlier 20 years and above, has come down to 4 to 5 years. You can imagine, once you slash and burn the area and go in for agriculture crop, and after the fertility is lost, what regrowth it can come within a matter of 4 or 5 years. And the consequences are, of course, reduction in the forest cover, and the quality is also affected, as we have seen in the change of the composition of the species, and decline in the availability of the preferred species, and the scenario giving way to lesser known species. Now this is a picture of showing overall view of the zooming. You can see the middle patches which is zoomed currently, and subsequently the adjoining areas will also be covered. Now as the cycle goes on, coming back to the original place was earlier 20 years and above. So you can expect some kind of a regrowth in that period, 20-25 years. But presently, with the zoom cycle of 4 to 5 years, hardly you get any growth. Now this is another overall picture. You can see the entire area is surrounded by forests, and the middle patches are subjected to slash and burn cultivation. And this is a closest view of the current zoom area. And looking at the industries, as I said, that after 1980-85, there have been a lot of sawmills and veneer units were established. Again, it is a semi-finished product. There's no plywood industries as such. And then in between, what happened was in 80s and 85s, large-scale supply of railway sleepers were taken up by the farmers through the department. And as a result, a lot of hardwood timber have gone out. And then when coming to the furniture industry, of course, by 85 or so, it started picking up. There has been a lot of migration from the villages to the towns, and because of that also, there's been a lot of demand for the furniture. Even now, the demand for furniture is quite high, and most of the furniture is going outside the state. And species such as Artocarpus and Malina were quite popular for furniture making. Now, of course, it was shifted to Cinnamon and Michaelia, and now presently, since teak plantations are available, plenty of teak is being used for furniture. And wood carving, of course, is especially associated with culture of the people of the state for a very long time. And you can see some of the pictures here. So this is actually we have about 16 tribes, and each tribe is unique in its own way, and they have all different cultures. And this is what we call it as a community hall. This belongs to Pochuri tribe, and this is completely made of wood. And just to show you some of the carvings which they make, the one on the left side is done by the Sangtam tribe, and on the right side is the Chakasang tribe. This is again a morong or community hall of a Angami tribe. This is another decorative carving in front of front door. In fact, many of the houses and the village community head and other places, they have a very big door, front door, with lots of carving. So this is, we have a handicrafts village at Dimapur, which is a cosmopolitan town in the state. where state government has financed, but still it is in the initial stages. This has to take. Most of it is catering to the local users, because they use a lot of wooden plates and wooden cups. Even in when we go out on tours, we used to have tea with the bamboo cups.
Can you please wrap it up?
Yeah, I will. This is another set of handicrafts at Coffs Village, and this is another this thing. This is just a picture where the entire thing is one single plank of Phobigolparensis. So one of our officers is standing there. So it's about almost 5 feet wide Phobigolparensis. Just to show you that these were the quality materials which are available then and not anymore. So this is, of course, we have a tourist hut which is exclusively again made by bamboo, and this is a community reserve hut, entirely a log one. So most of it is constructed in those areas by the logs and timber, whatever is available. Just to conclude, concluding this, we had the forest as an economic source, and there has been increased demand for timber, and the end users and the industries were demanding a very lot of material. And as a result, there was rise in prices and lesser availability of the preferred species. At the same time, zooming also impacted the prices. And because of this, the unsustainable removal and eventually shifting over to alternate species. And to overcome this, augmenting the resources through plantations and, of course, efficient utilization of timber and intervention of technology and composite wood industry, what is required. Eventually, all this process will lead to a reduced pressure on the natural forest and a sustainable management. Thank you.